Hey, everybody, welcome into another edition of Sal's House. Really, really appreciate all the great feedback and the people watching and listening. You don't have to watch. You can just kind of put it on your headphones and listen. It is on video all the time at the Sal Sports YouTube channel. Every couple of weeks, I like to bring in an interesting guest to Sal's House. Sometimes we're right here physically in the house. Sometimes we're virtual. And of course, it's always brought to you by Sports City Pizza Pub, 1407 Niagara Street in Buffalo. Was just there a couple of weeks ago. Had some friends in town for the Bills playoff games. Obviously, unfortunately, didn't turn out as well as we wanted it to here, but we had great pizza and wings, and they got beer, and they got all these great TVs. You can watch all the sporting events there. So thanks a lot to Mike and the gang down at Sports City Pizza Pub, 1407 Niagara Street, always helping to bring you Sal's House. I always have interesting guests that I'm looking for and I'm thinking about. And one that I should have thought about right away is a guy that I got to know a couple of years ago, actually. And I'll tell the story while he's on with me. But this guy's doing a lot of great things from Buffalo, and he's in the entertainment industry. And his name is Nicholas Denman. And Nick actually has a series, a pilot series that he filmed in Buffalo. It's called For Nothing. It's actually about kind of new school Buffalo Mafia meets old school Buffalo Mafia. There's a struggle. It's pretty cool. I was involved in it. We're going to talk all about that today. And he joins me right now in Sal's House. Nick, thanks a lot for joining me, man. I really appreciate you.
Hey, Sal. Thanks for having me on. It's been too long, my friend. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Where are you right now? You live in Florida, right?
Yeah, I live in Florida. I kind of split time, kind of traveling back and forth. Right now I'm in Tampa. So nice and sunny for me right now. And I managed to avoid most of that snow you guys just got.
Oh my gosh. Yes, for sure. It's the time of year to try and get away to Florida for sure. So maybe I'll be headed down there and we can kind of connect, because you and I got a chance to connect for the first time a couple of years ago for the series For Nothing. And here's the story. And then I'll kind of ask you about, you know, why you chose Buffalo, being from here, and you can talk about all that. But I saw one day, I'm at the gym, I'm working out. This is pre-COVID, and I'm going through my timeline on Twitter and social media, and I see Lauren Hall of Channel 2 here in Buffalo, and she did this story. Lauren. And Lauren did this story on this guy who's looking for extras in a mafia TV series in Buffalo. And I'm like, my name's Sal Capaccio, and I've been on TV. I can do this, right? So I reached out to Lauren. I said, hey, can you put me in touch with this person? She reached out to you. You're like, I know who Sal is. I'm a Bills fan. And from there, we connected, and it was awesome. So I appreciate you having me aboard. But just to know that you're from Buffalo, what's your story, and how did you get to be in a place where you're in the entertainment industry and making movies?
Yeah, well, first of all, when I heard that you wanted to be a part of the show, I was super excited because I'd obviously been following you for years, you know, big Bills fan, as you can see. I've got my Jim Kelly signed football back there, an Andre Reed signed helmet. So it's been a long journey for me as a Bills fan. And you've been a part of that journey for me with all of your reporting and little tidbits you've given the world along the way. So I was really excited when Lauren brought up to me that you might be interested and flattered. So I think I had a meeting with you and I said, I think I need you for more than an extra. And I think we actually got you in for a pretty solid role. And we'll talk about that a little bit more later. But as for myself, yeah, I was born in Buffalo, just a little bit south, you know, and basically spent most of my time in Angola and Eden and, you know, ran around in the south towns for a while, a little bit country, a little bit south city. So, yeah, I ended up moving away when I was in my teens. And then I went to the University of Florida. And so once I got a taste for the sunshine, I sort of stayed here. It's a little bit nicer at times, especially during the winter months, to be able to sit by a beach. But I never lost my roots and my love and affinity for Buffalo. You know, they say we travel well, and we really do. And it's you're born into it. And once you're born into it, you can't leave it, can't quit it. My uncles and aunts are there, you know, my mom and my stepdad are there. You know, my family worked all around the area for years and years, you know, at the Ford plant, the Chevy plant, you know, 30 years, you know, kind of like lifetime commitments, from my grandfather, from my stepdad. And, you know, so for me, when I think of home, it's always still Buffalo. You know, I can be anywhere in the world enjoying whatever beach I'm at, and I keep coming back. And, I've come back, you know, for months at a time, you know, you know, throughout the years. I don't think there's ever been more than 4 or 5 months that have gone by that I haven't come back home. And yeah, so anyway, when I started branching out, you know, into like, you know, the great big world of after college, I had an English degree.
Let me ask you, did you go to Florida to do this, to be in movies and the film industry?
No, so I went for school, you know, originally I went to the University of Florida. That's why you can see this little orange emblem over here on my shirt. It's a little orange and blue for Go Gators. Yep. But yes, I got the English degree, and I quickly realized that you have a few options with an English degree. You can either, you know, be a teacher, or you can, you know, write for corporate America. And I just really didn't like either of those options. So I wrote my first great big work, which was For Nothing, which is a novel, which the show ended up being adapted from. So I actually have one of the books here. This is, you can see right here. And on the cover, this was commissioned by me, Buffalo great artist Jesse Horst, actually did this artistic piece here. And that's Shea's Theater going in
that's the background, awesome.
Through the assassin of our book. And so then I wrote a sequel called Buffalo Soldiers. And this one here, I'll kind of center it for you. Yep. You can see that's the entrance to Bethlehem Steel.
Wow.
So, you know,
it's really cool.
The books take place there. And, you know, it was just one of those things where they say, write what you know. And if you're from Buffalo and you have an Italian last name, which my mother's last name is Lo Galbo, then you probably have or know somebody that was involved throughout the 70s and 80s in some way in the life. And so I wrote about home, and I wrote about the stories that I heard growing up, and then obviously created an entire fictional world and fictional mafia family around it. And with little historical tidbits that if you know anything about the mafia activity in the city of Buffalo, you might say, that's a little bit close to true. But we changed it just enough to, you know, keep everybody safe.
Oh, that's awesome. And you're an actor too. You're a part of this. Like, you decided to kind of put yourself in there. Where does that part of you come from? The acting part?
Yeah. So, you know, like yourself, Sal, you know, we were talking about evolving as an entertainer earlier and just, you know, finding new ways to kind of connect with people. And, you know, I got a huge thrill out of, you know, writing my books, and they popped to the bestsellers, you know, on Amazon's lists pretty much, you know, within the first couple months. And it was like right around the advent of like the Kindle. And so people were looking for kind of, you know, cheap ebooks right to buy. And so I kind of caught lightning in a bottle with releasing my ebook just as that stuff was all taking off with like the Nook and the Kindle. And I was fortunate. However, like I quickly realized that I wanted to tell stories in a variety of capacities. I didn't want to just do it as a writer. I wanted to do it as an actor. I didn't want to just do it through books. I wanted to do it through TV and film. So I enrolled in classes at the sprightly young age of 28 years old. I thought, well, it's now or never. So I started taking classes and started through that effort and that journey, connecting with people that were involved in the film and TV industry.
It's amazing. I think about sometimes, you know, I always joke, I'm the only man who voluntarily left Florida to come to Buffalo, New York. And I know you love Buffalo and you love spending time here, but I did it at the age of 37 to restart my radio career. Right. And now, and it's been obviously the best decision you know, I've made in my career. And it's a great story that you share too. And I think a lot of people can kind of draw inspiration from that. It's never too late to do what you love and you're passionate about in life.
Right. Correct. And that's it. And, you know, and as you evolve as a human, you're just going to have different sections, different segments to your life. And, you know, one thing about acting, which is interesting, is there's always a need for people in different age categories to fulfill certain roles. So people might think, oh, well, you know, I'm too old to start. And it's like, well, no, you're not. You're actually probably exactly what they need. And as you get older, a lot of people have that same attitude of, you know, I'm kind of done, can't teach an old dog new tricks. So the need for people in those upper age categories is actually bigger than you might think, because not a lot of people continue to go for it. They either wash out or give up.
No doubt. All right. So we hear about this. I hear about this. We connect. You're like, hey, I'm going to be up in Buffalo. We're going to be shooting again. This is a little bit pre-COVID. And I'd say that because we have to go through the timeline of, you know, where we are now, where all this happened. So I was told, hey, let's meet. It was a meeting at the A-Loft, I believe. Is that Pro, right? And shout out to the A-Loft, by the way. They're great people over there. And, you're like, hey, we're going to meet at the A-Loft. So I have no idea what I'm walking into. I walk into this room and I see you and a couple other people, and I don't really know you yet. And you introduce yourself. And then it was just really us, but other people kept getting shuttled in. One of the people that came in was Seymour Knox Jr., right? He came in and I'm like, oh my, and I know him just kind of through my travels around here and sports and things like that. And he was a part of this as, what is it, like a location person? Like how you describe this?
Yeah, so first of all, Seymour is wonderful. He's a wonderful yes. human being. And for those of you that don't know, the Knox family used to own the Buffalo Sabres. So they're kind of old school legacy in the area. You might also know it from the Albright Knox Museum. Yep. And that's been a huge project, a huge rejuvenation for the city of Buffalo. An absolute amazing effort that's finally concluding now, I believe. And it is open for visitors. So Seymour.
By the way, that's now AKG, the Gunlock building. It's amazing. The Gunlock building, Jeffrey Gunlock. Mm-hmm. And I've gotten to know Jeff and his wife, Barb, and they have done an amazing job over there. And he knows Seymour very well as well. So you're right about that. I mean, it all kind of comes full circle here with these relationships in Buffalo. Very, you know, it's a bigger city, but a small community.
Yeah, that's it. And everybody's interconnected and everybody's willing to lift the place up. And, you know, I think that's the key to, you know, the whole, you know, city of good neighbors, you know, moniker is just like, You live it, you breathe it, you don't think twice about it. And it's not something that you do for the label. It's just something you do because you love the area and the people. And so Seymour walks in. He was introduced to me via one of our producers in the area. And he and I just hit it off. I think he ended up traveling around with us 90 to 95% of the days that we were there. We got, you know, the firsthand tour from him of Knox Farms. And, you know, we used some of the locations that he had brought to the forefront. And, you know, he's just to this day is a friend of mine. And you know, we reach out, we wish each other a Merry Christmas, happy birthday. And just couldn't be more pleased with, you know, some of the relationships like Seymour that I've made along the way.
And one of the relationships, unfortunately, since has passed, Joey Giambra. And boy, I'll tell you what, if you're going to cast a mafia series, this guy is central casting. It was amazing meeting him. He fit the role perfectly.
Joe left the mark. You know, there's a few people that you meet along the way that are so inspirational and so just personal when they meet you and just open up, and then, you know, cause you to open up to them, and they forge connections that you weren't anticipating. So Joe walks in, you know, I think he is like 80 years old or so, and just dressed as the part. And I said to myself, as soon as he walked in, I was like, that's the guy. Just if he doesn't have like a squeaky high-pitched voice, that's the guy, you know? And he comes in and he shakes my hand, and we just sit down, and he didn't read for me. We just talked for an hour. Love and it. I said, okay, all you need to do is be this guy. And that's it. And he was great. The very first day I met him, he took me to an old Italian restaurant, like through a back door. We sat there, was like three tables, and we ate, you know, spaghetti together. And just had a wonderful chat. He was like a Renaissance man. The guy played jazz. He acted. He used to be a detective. I mean, just an amazing life. And he's one of those people that once as a writer, you love to speak to, because you just have a wealth of information, and he just gives you so many stories naturally that you can pull from and say, wow, I can include this, I can include that. Yep. And unfortunately, he was a COVID casualty. You know, just to kind of spring it forward a little bit, you know, we filmed the pilot during COVID when we didn't know what COVID was. It was right on the forefront. And so, you know, obviously he was a little bit of an older gentleman, and the immune system probably was a little bit different than some of the other, you know, 30, 40 year olds on cast. And we wrapped, and then he got sick, and unfortunately, you know, he passed away. So if you check the pilot out, you can see we have an in loving memory to Joe, and he's a guy I'll never forget.
So then you say to me, we're at this in this room, and you're like, Sal, I got a couple of roles I envision you for. And he says, Nick and your partner who's out in California, I forget his name right now. I'm sorry.
We've got a few of them, but you know, they're the biggest ones, especially in writing the pilot, with Sean Gloria. He's a fabulous writer.
Right. That's
He's been in you know, the Black Mafia series, you know, and he was just, you know, just amazing actor, an amazing person. And then I have the director, Stephen Quach, who is a brilliant young mind, who has been, you know, lockstep with us from the beginning. And, you know, I think at the time he directed the pilot, he was only 24 years old, directing the likes of Michael Madsen, Daniel Baldwin, Robert Miano. Just a wonderful experience to see him thrive in that environment. And then our other co-writer, Thomas Humphreys, who is over in Wales in the UK. And he is, he and Sean and myself wrote all the rest of the episodes together in tandem.
And I think you and Sean, Stephen, you say to me, all right, so you could be a news reporter basically. And every once in a while you come out to talk about how there was a body found or something's going on with the mafia. And I'm like, yeah, I could be a reporter. Then you're like, or we have another role for you. It's called the cleaner. And you're literally the guy that goes in and cleans up the bodies after the mafia hit. And I'm like, dude, I need this role, right? I mean, it was awesome. I loved it. You had that vision for me. It was super cool. And I learned a lot.
You crushed it. You're really great job. You know, any mafia story has to have somebody who gets rid of the bodies. You know, Pulp Fiction, I think it's called like the wolf or something like that. And, you know, for us, it's the cleaner. And you just embodied it really well. You know, he's kind of a type A personality who has, you know, what do you call it? Where you don't like germs.
Obsessive, like disorder. Yes, that's right. OCD. He has OCD.
He's OCD. So, you know, cleaning is his thing. And, you know, I remember you just sitting there in the back of the van trying to put the gloves on and, you know, fold up towels and organize them meticulously. And yeah, you crushed it.
Well, let me tell that this is that is not my particular personality. Like I'm like super energetic out there, but what's funny is, so I'm doing this and I had never been a part of this. So I go to a warehouse, I think on the west side of Buffalo. We're going to talk about locations in a minute. Mm-hmm. You can tell me how you did all this, but I go to a warehouse, the west side of Buffalo, and I walk in. I'm like, oh my God, there's a director's chair. They're putting makeup on me. I got this suit. I got to wear like a janitorial basically suit. You're putting a shovel in my hand. And I'm like, wow, there's smoke in the building. Like this is the real deal. Like I have no idea what to expect. I was on stage and I was Conrad Birdie and Bye Bye Birdie my senior year in high school. Right? I can get up there and sing, right? But this is totally different. There's cameras, there's different angles. And you walk up to me, you're like, listen, you have to have this type of just mentality. Nothing, always one track, OCD. And I'm thinking, and you're directing me through this. So I think we had 5 or 6 takes, which might be normal. I don't really know.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, sometimes it can be 20 or 30.
Right.
Had times like that. So nailing it in 5 is pretty solid. And I think you were there the last day. It was like the last.
Very last day.
Dude, that was rap. That was like rap moment.
And you know, part of the reason was you accommodated me. I was actually on a cruise with my family and we got back and you said, hey, we can shoot your spot. And you're like a couple of days after you get back, which is what happened. So I got to see the very end when you celebrated with the crew, the final shoot, which was super cool for me. And it wasn't because I was part of that. It was just because it happened to be happenstance. That was the last one. Mm-hmm. But you guys, that was it, man. You were done. It was over and it's a wrap and you guys were celebrating and it was super cool. So yeah, I mean, that was a really great experience for me, obviously. I had a great time doing that. Tell me about why you chose the different locations where you did shoot in Buffalo.
Yeah. Well, yeah. So being from the South Towns, you know, I didn't want that kind of environment too much. It's a little bit different. It's more country. We chose out in like Lakeview for one of the homes for, you know, one of the mafia bosses. So it's a little bit outside of the, you know, the hubbub of a city, you know, somewhere a little more quiet where he can be with his family and safe. So we chose Lakeview for that. And then we were kind of shown around the city by, you know, Buffalo Filmworks scouting department by Seymour, by Joe Giambra, and just people that really knew the area and said, hey, you know, this area would probably fit this scene or this one would fit that scene. I believe the warehouse that we chose for you for that final moment was there's a company up there that was instrumental in helping us film it called ND Studios. And that was their warehouse. That's where they stored all their equipment. And, you know, the trucks and things like that. And they said, why don't we just film it here? We don't have to move the equipment very far. You've got your warehouse. We've got smoke machines. And I said, you know what? Done deal. And that's why we picked that spot. So it's just really, you know, trying to highlight the area, too. We didn't want to just show, like, there's like this idea that Buffalo is dirty. And there's this idea that it's old because, you know, steel town cities and this and that. But there's been a huge renaissance in Buffalo. I mean, it isn't that way anymore. There's still some of it. And we definitely wanted to show that and show the roots of the city. And we did, you know, we had, you know, some stuff in the steelworks and over there. And we had in Silo City, we had other locations. And we had some great drone shots of the city in general, especially downtown. But we also wanted to show like there's nice things here, too. And we wanted to make sure that, you know, the nice houses were shown and the nice restaurants were shown. And throughout the series, we're hopeful to show a lot of the autumn foliage and things like that. So that way it can really get its due, not just as this industrial, old city, but the Renaissance that it's gone through now to make it thrive. You know, like you mentioned earlier, old school versus new school. I mean, that's the theme in general. So it's, old school mafia, new school mafia.
And I promise people, if they watch it, they'll recognize so many places like a Coulter Bay. I think there was a shot right in there, right outside.
We did Lucky Day Whiskey Bar over there. And we used the alley right out back. I think Lucky Day, we used maybe three locations within the one location. We were in their basement. We were in their alley. We were in their that beautiful bar that they have. We were over in Ulrich's Tavern. We spent a lot of time over there at Ulrich's, and they made us feel like family. And I think they threw us a pasta night. The entire crew was there. And all the actors and they just opened up the doors for us and really made us feel at home. So that's just what Buffalo does, though. I mean, something cool happens in the city, and you make the city proud, and they treat you like family.
And if there is a scene in there, I don't give it away, but there's a really cool mafia type of scene. You do come out of the alley, and when the car rides away, the shot widens, and you can see downtown, and you can see the lights on the two Statue of Liberties they have downtown. And everybody would be like, "Oh yeah, I've been there a million times going to Sabres games or Bisons games."
Yeah, that's right. And I think actually, there's the little overpass there, the pedestrian overpass.
It says
"Welcome to Buffalo" right across the top, and
it's amazing
as it pans up. So, we definitely wanted to make Buffalo, almost as important as any character in the story. Especially the winters are really important in season one, and how cold it is, and things like that. So we wanted to make sure we captured it appropriately, but also put a nice little flavor on it, so that way people can see, Buffalo for what it really is.
And one of the ways you do that is through the opening. I love the song, the shots, the drone shots, the bridges. It's really cool. You see the neighborhood you guys go into. So that's a really cool part of it. Speaking of characters, you got some pretty big names in this. You just mentioned a couple of them a little while ago, but I mean, a Baldwin is in there, Michael Madsen, right? I mean, what's your relationship? How do you, come up with guys like this and people like this, actors and actresses like this, to be a part of something like this in Buffalo?
Yeah, first of all, these guys are legends, especially in the mafia genre. I mean, Michael Madsen, Reservoir Dogs, Kill Bill. He's just an amazing actor. He's even done things like Free Willy, and he's just a phenomenal talent. And then Robert Miano also. I think Robert Miano and Michael Madsen were both in Donnie Brasco. One was Sonny Red, and one was Sonny Black. And then we had, Daniel Baldwin. He jumped in right away. He started doing radio interviews with us in New York. He lives in New York still. So he was instrumental. And generally, just the way that we got him was we sent him a script and we said, "Hey, we'd like to have you." And these guys were so great. I mean, they believed in the project. They believe in the project, and they took cheap rates for us. They weren't sitting there on pomp and circumstance saying they needed to be in the best hotel room. I think everybody stayed at the A-Loft, which is a fine place, but they weren't saying I needed to be in a suite or anything like that, So it was just really cool. We went to, I took the three of them out to Nick's, the breakfast spot there in town. And they had a nice brunch together. So they were loving the area, loving the food, loving the people. And they keep getting on me. They're like, "When are we going back? When are we going back?"
Well, we can talk about that and how we can get back. But let's just kind of go back to when all this happened. This is COVID. This is 2020. I know I filmed my spot February, early March. COVID hits really the way it did at the end of March and then into April. And we all know what happened from there. You guys had to kind of shut everything down, I would guess. What happened in that time period in that area where you're putting everything out, you're trying to put it together, but all of a sudden kind of COVID hits you?
Yeah, we had a series of pretty big bumps, unfortunately. And hey man, if anything's worth doing, it's gonna be hard. But also the timing just couldn't have been worse in a lot of ways. We wrap this thing, COVID I think is the next week comes out as a thing. And so within the next month, everything shut down for over a year. I mean, you couldn't film anything. There were so many regulations. Remember, we're all sitting at home with masks. You weren't allowed to go shopping. You weren't allowed to go to restaurants, all that crazy stuff. So, you know, we encountered that. That set us back almost a year. And then just as things opened up again and we start getting some traction again, we had the SAG and writer strikes hit. And so for, you know, the last 2.5 years, we've basically had 18 months where we weren't allowed to work. We did utilize that time effectively to kind of create connections and continue writing the rest of the series and this and that. But yeah, I mean, those were serious hiccups that we're still trying to overcome.
No doubt about it. And now, you know, it's still out there. The pilot's there. The pilot is there. You've done it. You've only shot one episode, I imagine. And I think you can tell me, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's there. It's all put together. It's ready to go. And now you're waiting to kind of do the rest of it. So this is the part where I tell everybody, hey, we can make this happen still. I'd love to be a part of it. I know Nick wants to make this happen. Lots of people want to make this happen. Highlighting Buffalo, have this series filmed in Buffalo. What needs to happen now to go back to where you are and where things stand?
Yeah, so, you know, there's a lot of people have kind of coalesced around the project in a meaningful way. For instance, we already have a sales and distribution team that's agreed to shop it once we finish the additional 9 episodes. And, you know, these are folks that go to, you know, the Cannes film market, MIPCOM, and these different places where you sell television series and films. That is their job. And so they've signed on to push this forward. At the moment, what we really need to do is just film the next 9 episodes, because, you know, a pilot is something that you could probably sell a network that will then take the idea and then kind of take it as their own. And I don't want to really dismantle what we've built. I want to keep the same cast. I want to keep the same crew. I want to keep it in Buffalo. I don't want to just do exteriors occasionally and say it's in Buffalo, which, you know, a lot of these bigger, production companies will say, well, we'll do it in our studio in Atlanta. And then we'll do exteriors in Buffalo and it will look like it's in Buffalo. And so my big push is to keep it as much in Buffalo as possible. So really what we need to do is probably find, you know, some local investment, people who believe in the project the same way that we do. We're trying to raise roughly $6 million to do the additional 9 episodes, which sounds like a lot to, you know, people like you and me, Sal, but for a television series, it's really not that bad. Our effort right now is to see, okay, who believes in this? Who wants to bring this project to Buffalo along with us? And then who wants to create jobs, create a legacy, and be the person that says, hey, you know that TV show in Buffalo? That was mine. And then they'll never have to buy another drink in town again.
That's amazing. I love it. People can go somewhere. Where would they go if they want more information, if they want to see the trailer, anything like that?
Yeah. And we could maybe throw a link up for the trailer if you want at the end. And then, as far as, you know, reaching out, we could maybe put a little, like, an email, you know, down there. They can also find me on Twitter at Nicholas Denman, Instagram at Nicholas Denman, and, you know, on Facebook at Nicholas Denman. So it's pretty simple. If you know my name, you'll be able to find me and reach out to me.
And what else? What other things are you working on, man? You got other things going? And I mean, you don't have to spoil anything, but I'm sure this isn't just the only project you're involved in.
No. I mean, obviously I'm an actor. I did some pretty cool films recently. I did Wolfhound, which, was a World War II film. It starred James Maslow from Big Time Rush. I share screen with him. I've also been in American Rust, which was a Morna Tierney TV show. I can't remember his name now. Doesn't really matter, but it was over on Showtime. And so I've done some projects, you know, as an actor, and then also as a writer, you know, put out another book unrelated to these two. And then still, you know, I'm writing screenplays. We're pushing a heist film right now through the same sales distribution company that's backing the For Nothing effort. They're out there raising the funds for, you know, this international heist thriller. And so I'm just keeping busy, writing, creating, producing, and just like I said earlier, just trying to find different ways to connect with an audience and tell stories and, you know, maybe make people forget for a minute what's going on in their daily lives that gives them trouble.
And by the way, again, I just want to reiterate to everybody, For Nothing is not dead at all. It's still very much alive. You can be involved in it. You can help out. You want to get it back in Buffalo. You want to maybe be a part of it, anything like that. You can reach out to Nick. That said, just don't kill me off anytime soon if we do this. Okay. I mean, you don't, you know, the cleaner, I got to be cleaning bodies for a while.
Well, Sal, if you read the book, you might know a little bit about your character arc.
See, that's right. You told me. I didn't want to spoil anything. You told me though. I'm in it for a while, and then maybe we'll see how things go a couple of years down the road, I guess.
Yeah, that's right.
What taking a book to a movie? I do want to ask you. You know, people always talk about how different it is. How different is the book to the movie? To the series, excuse me.
Yeah. So, significantly, mostly because we are starting the series 3 years before the first book.
Okay.
And so what we wanted to do was give ourselves longevity as a series. We didn't want to get to book two and where I'm halfway through book three and say, okay, we have three books of material. So we started at 3 years, which would be three seasons before you even enter the material from the series as you know it. Now, the material from the series, as you would know it from reading it, informs the backstory, of course. But a lot of the characters don't meet up into where they interact with each other in book one until season three. And so, you know, we gave ourselves a lot of creative flexibility that way, too, so we could kind of flesh out the world a lot differently than we did in book one, but also kind of come to some of the main plot points within the series by about season three.
Nick, thanks, man. Really appreciate it. Best of luck. I'm excited. I want to get this thing going again. I want to help out as much as I can. Anybody in Buffalo wants to be a part of this, help out. Just reach out to Nick on Twitter, on Instagram. Look at his here. I'm gonna put your name up there. There's Nicholas Denman. There you see his first name and his last name on the screen. That's where you can find him on Twitter, X, on Instagram. You want to be a part of it? Definitely try and reach out and do that. And the next time you come to Buffalo, we are going to Sports City Pizza Pub because they help make this possible at Sal's house, and they have great pizza and wings right here on the west side.
Well, you know, I've actually been there, and I love it.
I love it.
Yeah, and it's an amazing place. Great pizza, great wings, and I think I've watched football there at least three weekends. So, yeah, I would do it again in a heartbeat with you, Sal.
All right, no doubt. And then maybe we'll do it during football season next year. You got to come up and watch your Bills. I know you're a big Bills fan. Crushing loss for all of us, but this is therapeutic to talk to other fans about it all the time.
I had to turn off I had to mute anything Buffalo Bills related for about three days after the game. It was just too much. And you know, I really had my hopes up, and you know, those guys, they played their hearts out, and I love them. And you know, there's always next year.
All right, so go and buy the book for nothing. Get it, download it, however you have to do it, and then look for the trailer. Find Nick and get involved. Nick, thanks a lot for coming in to sell. Yeah, go ahead.
So there is a former Buffalo Bill in the pilot.
Yes,
John Feliciano, who is now in the Super Bowl.
John Feliciano, that's right. I'm not going to give away his fate.
I don't give away his fate. I wrote to him and said, you know, congratulations on reaching the Super Bowl, and he said thank you. And yeah, he's a wonderful human being, a gentle giant, and absolutely cool tie-in for the city that we have. At least we have one of our guys in the big show.
Okay, without giving anything away, I will ask you, what was it like to wrestle him in the movie? You kind of had to fight him a little bit in the pilot.
It was completely fiction, and I'll leave it at that, because that guy is so big that it wouldn't. It wouldn't have been a fair fight in any which way.
Well, John Feliciano, he is in for nothing. He's also in the Super Bowl. Nick Denman is the producer, actor, director, everything, man. You wear a lot of hats, and you're bringing it to Buffalo. Let's hope we do soon. Nick, thanks for joining me in Sal's house.
Thank you so much, Sal. I appreciate you, and hopefully I'll see you soon.
All right, for sure. And thank you once again to Sports City Pizza Pub, 1407 Niagara Street. You can find all Sal's House episodes right here on the Sal Sports YouTube channel.